everyone. I'm really, really excited today. I'm really happy that you guys showed up. And the fact that we are hosting our third episode on Paytm Money Talks. And today we have something really, really exciting with you. We have a conversation set up with the one and the only Mr. Rakshat Srivastava, who's one of the famous YouTube influencers that are out there, and the fund manager of Mirae Asset, who's been looking after the Hang Seng Fund. So before I start, and be all excited to bring this information that is really, really valuable for you, I just want to put certain things in front of you. The fact that please call your friends. This is the right time. Message them. Tell them it's a free session. You know, you can just come in, hop on board and learn from the biggest minds out there. And before we do that, there's a couple of things that I want to say about Paytm Money Talks, a little about myself and our ambition with Paytm Money Talks. So what we're trying to do here is I'm Muzammil Sayed and I work at Paytm Money. And my job here is to build products, services and a little bit platforms that allow two people to engage, talk to each other and learn a little bit about investing in general. So the idea is that there are so many things happening out there. You know, the market is vulnerable and there's so many factors that affect the market in one way or the other. And what I'm trying to do is trying to give you a platform where you can speak to experts and figure out your own personal queries in one form or the other. The idea is to help you make an informed decision, investment decision for your future. So with that, we need to understand various perspectives. There's always to learn. I am learning. I'm sure all the people who are in market, they will say that nobody knows it at all, but everybody's learning at all point of time. And that is why this platform is really, really important for me. Paytm Money Talks is our way of trying to get you the best knowledge. So I will request everyone to please, you know, subscribe us and tell us really exactly what we want to do. You know, what your questions are, what are the kind of things that you would want to cover through this, you know, and let us know how we can improve and give you better valuable content. So before we begin, I think we should put down the disclaimer. And the disclaimer is the fact that this is a conversation between people who have their own opinions. And what you have to do through something by watching this video in one form or the other is to understand our perspective, understand people's perspective, why somebody made it, why somebody likes it, what are our thoughts, and then make an informed decision by yourself. Go figure out, do your own research. Don't rely on somebody's words at all. You know, there are ample of literature out there which you can pick up, their books now, readily accessible and whatnot. But the idea is to not take everything we say on the face value. We have to come to a point where we know why we are investing in anything. So with this, I'm excited to you know, introduce to you Mr. Rakshat Srivastava. Mr. Rakshat Srivastava is are you on board? Yes. Can you hear us, Akshat?
Yeah, hello. Perfect. Yes.
Yeah. Awesome. So before Akshat introduces himself, the man who needs no introduction, I would tell you about how I got exposed to Akshat. It was one of such, you know, nights when I'm trying to figure out what happened in the market, what is the decision I need to take, and things like that. And then I was doing some relevant keywords, you know, and then Akshat popped up when maybe he was starting his journey on YouTube back then. But I saw his video and I was like, damn, he really gets to the point, you know, like he's actually allowing me to understand the back end mechanics about why things are happening the way they are happening. And then I started following him. From there, I realized that Akshat is not just a finance guru. Sorry if I may call you that, but Akshat is not just a finance guru. Akshat also talks to you about how do you take yourself as an individual and expose yourself to opportunities or possibilities where you can gather excess, you know, additional sources of income. Through his videos, he helps us navigate through these paths and allow us to understand what he's done and what you can learn from it. From how to make a CV to how to apply for jobs, what are things that can happen in consulting. Mr. Rakshat Srivastava here has a valid experience, and you may see that in his resume as well across all those places. So I'm really happy. I was really excited to have you on board with us, and I can't you know, say anything more beyond that. So Akshat, would you please introduce, like, tell us a little bit about your journey so far and what made you become the YouTube phenomena that you are right now and a little bit about it.
Sure, Muzammil. So thank you so much for such a warm introduction, first and foremost. Really appreciate it. I'll keep it brief, practical, to the point. So more about me. I think Muzammil covered a lot. So on top of that, I am a passionate teacher. I love teaching. I've been teaching for the last 1.5 decade now. Right from my college, I used to teach. That's point one. All right, that I absolutely love teaching. That is my passion. That is something that I would continue to do throughout my life. I've signed a book deal, so my book is also coming out, so which is again like this is my second area of expertise, which is writing. So I'm a professional writer. That is where I started my career also, in a way. So that is point two. Point three, I'm a firm advocate of holistic money, right? By holistic money, what I mean is that you don't become rich just by earning money. You become rich by doing a lot more things with it. In the sense, for example, you should be time rich also, right? There is just no point in terms of making billions and not having the time to enjoy it. So I'm a firm advocate in terms of optimizing your time. I'm a firm advocate in terms of improving your skills. Yes, I talk a lot about how to invest in stocks, how to invest in different asset classes, cryptocurrencies, bonds, etc. But if you ask me, hey, one thing that will give me the most amount of returns, what is that one single thing that I can do? I would always, always, always say that please go and invest in your skill set, improving your skill set. That is my philosophy, and that is even what I adopt, right? So this would be like a good segue into our conversation. Yeah.
Nice, nice, nice. And because I follow you, I'm asking some questions that I already know answers to. So I just want to know a little bit about what made you quit your high-paying job? Like, you know, you had a wonderful thing going on and some things that most of us, you know, like I came from a premier B school and, you know, we all wanted to look at, you know, career paths a very different way. You had what we wanted and then you gave it up and then, you know, began from scratch. So if you could tell us a little bit about your, you know, the emotion that went behind it and what made you pull through whatever you've done so far, so that people who are listening to us can learn a bit or two from it.
Absolutely. So very quickly there, so it's so for me, I've always pursued multiple things at once, right? I work hard. I try to pursue several things and in one go, so to say. I always kept on doing or tinkering a little bit on the sides, even when I was pursuing my full-time job. So it was not as if that, hey, I'm working at a nonprofit, which was my first job, so I would only do nonprofit. Back when I started my career, my first job was with a nonprofit. But at the same time, since I had a good GMAT score, so I started teaching for the GMAT, right? So that became my first business that I started, so to say. Then subsequently, when I went to INSEAD, I started coaching people how to get into BCG, Bain, McKinsey, right? So that became a side gig at the time I was enrolled at a business school. Then subsequently, when I started another job, I did something on the sideline. So I always continued doing it. So it was not as if that when I decided to switch from corporate to entrepreneurship back in 2018, it was not a fresh start to me. I had like years of training in terms of becoming an entrepreneur up until that point. So,
So the thing is that you need to hustle and keep trying new things and you never know what takes you where. And I've realized that in life you need to, you know, better your probabilities, you know, in one form or the other. Just expose yourself to the right probabilistic set and, you know, give your 100%. And with investing in general, this is what we're trying to do, put our pedal and let people understand various things that there are. A little personal, so you have multiple sources of income. Now you've gotten on this journey. How many sources of income do you have right now? How many ways do you use your entrepreneur skills in the adventure that you have built for yourself?
So I have made a separate video on this altogether where I disclose that I have 17 income streams, right? So yeah, that's the number I would say, but it's very hard to define what a particular income stream is because I've invested across multiple businesses. So if I consider each of these business separately, then, you know, the number would be higher from that perspective.
Yeah.
But yeah, if I have to give you a rough estimate, it would be 17.
Damn. And stock market, how much does it become a part of the entire thing? How much is stock market investing like contributes to your entire income stream?
So to be honest, like I do stock markets from the sense that, hey, you have to invest. There is just no other option because if you're not investing, then you're losing money. That's point one. Yeah. You have to invest. It's not an income stream per se. It's just a way to preserve your wealth. I see it that as the number one goal of investing in the stock market, that that's the most effective way of preserving your wealth, right? So that is the number one reason why I'm active in the stock markets. I've been investing for several years. Growth, yes, some years it gives you a decent return, some years you're not getting that higher return. So it fluctuates from season to season, so to say. Like last year was a great season because the stock markets literally grew by 100% roughly, so to speak. So it was a great time from that perspective. So just to put a number, I don't depend on stock markets to make income. I depend on businesses per se. I have always been an entrepreneur. I will always continue to be an entrepreneur. I would always continue to be a teacher. So that is my primary goal per se.
Yeah.
So, very hard to predict, right? I mean, hey, what percentage, depending on the year, it can range from like anywhere between like 20% to 35-40% also of the entire income.
Yes. So you're like a true definition of don't put all your eggs in one basket, and how we can go about learning from it.
I'm like a firm believer in diversification. I genuinely feel that you need to be diversified in today's economy, be it in terms of the types of jobs that you're pursuing, where you are investing. We can have that detailed conversation, but to cut the long story short, one key principle that I adhere to is diversification. It is extremely important in today's economy. There is no such thing as a golden rule that, hey, just go and invest in this particular asset class and it will grow like crazy. No, nothing like that.
Yeah.
Things change with time. The returns from that keeps going up and down, right? For example, in our parents' time, investing in real estate was probably one of the best things that they could have done. That is their era, right? If you ask now where we are heading in terms of numbers wise, you know, it could be stocks, cryptocurrencies, etc. We don't know, right, where the world will be 10 years from now. World changes at a massive pace. No one can predict. So we don't know. And therefore, the only principle that works, according to me, is diversification, sensible diversification.
And in this pursuit, who are the kind of investors that you follow? You must have learned it from, like, you must have your own mentors, that value investing that I try to learn from different people who are out there. Who are your mentors? Who do you look up to?
So I actually look to business people. I don't look to investors per se, right? I'm more fascinated by how people are building businesses, what new stuff that they are doing, how intelligently they are executing marketing plans, how intelligently they are building systems and processes that's helping customers. So I'm more obsessed on the business operation side of things rather than investing side of things per se. But if I have to quote a couple of investors, then I'm very, then I would be influenced by quite a lot by Ray Dalio, right? So that is like my number one go-to person from investment philosophy point of view. The best part is that he's someone who is open to changing mind, right? And that is the best thing that you can do as an investor. It is not as if that, you know, because if you're closed, if you never want to sort of undertake the viewpoint that, hey, you know what, this is the worldview I have and it will always stay the same, then you are probably wrong about it, because the world changes and so should your investment style. So with time, any investor who's open to changing their mind rationally and logically, that is a sensible way of investing, in my opinion. And Ray Dalio depicts that. Business people that I look up to is Mark Cuban. I really look up to him.
Nice.
Sort of conducts businesses, his philosophy, the type of risk taking that he takes, the judgment that he has. So I think Mark Cuban would be one of the key people that I would look towards. Yeah.
On the similar lines, considering this is all for viewers to understand a bit of how you think and what you are, if there is like one book that you've read over your journey, you know, that you thought maybe for a new to market person, you know, like the first book somebody should read, what is that book according to you, so that, you know, we can, you know, they can take the first steps, you know, it all depends on who teaches the first thought, you know, like once I first learned probability, it was really bad. And then I saw Khan Academy and then I realized, oh, this is what it means. So what's that one book for you that actually made you feel, oh, this is something that everybody should read?
So I would not say one book per se, but I would, I was very influenced by Dr. Rajan's economic commentary, right? So that really inspired me to learn more about economics, finance, stock markets. Because honestly, like, stock market is an outcome of economics and finance, right? So I am like more of a economics guy, right? So I read economics, I study economics, I still spend a lot of time understanding consumer psychology, economics, macro, micro, both. I still read a lot of commentary by Dr. Rajan and a bunch of other major macroeconomists. So I would rather say that, you know, start with economics and you have to pick a book, then pick like a book, something like Undercover Economist. It's a very good starting point.
Nice.
If you want to learn economics, right? So I think that's good. If you want to learn investing per se, then Psychology of Money is really good. It's you know, it's one of the foremost books as we speak. So that's very good. And I hope that when I get to write my book, you guys will read it. Right? So I think
Definitely. I'll definitely want to understand your point of view, and just to understand, you know, how successful people think who are out there, have been doing it longer than I have, and my market kind of repeats itself in one way or the other. It's better to learn from others' mistakes, at least in markets. So thanks for letting us a little bit inside in your personal self, and we'll move to the next section where we're trying to understand what the market situation is right now. So the next section is called Market Lens, which we would ask you certain specific questions about, you know, what do you think India is going through right now, and other things. So the first question for you that we have on Market Lens is, what are your views on India and India's growth right now, considering the current scenario that we have, the third, you know, the new species of coronavirus is out there, and what, you know, the market is consolidating a bit, or correcting rather, I would say. Where do you think India is going? What is your opinion?
Sure. So very simple way of analyzing it is that the population of the world is about 7.5, right? And India's population is 1.35, right? So if humanity has to grow, then India has to grow with it, right? So that's a simple argument from a macro point of view. So from that perspective, you know, the human civilization from this stage cannot grow without India growing, right? So
yeah,
I'm very bullish on India from that simple sense, because the greatest asset for humanity is the human capital. India provides a lot of human capital. Rest of the other things will fall in line, right? For example, right now there are multiple major macro challenges for India, that the cost of capital is very high in India. The productivity rate is low because we are not engaged in high-end manufacturing or high-end tech. Right? So as more capital flows, so this problem is getting solved to a certain extent. You might have seen that a lot of unicorns are being built in India. So that, what does that indicate? It simply indicates that the flow of money will improve in India. Along with that, productivity will also improve with time. So from a macro perspective, that's the long-term lens that I'm putting, that it will 100% grow. Like if you keep a 20, 30-year viewpoint, 100% that will happen. Short-term turmoil, yes, definitely, right? I mean, markets keep going up and down. COVID problem, new strain of COVID is there, which is very unfortunate. But having said this, you know, when the first wave of COVID could not literally wipe out the economy, then of course the new strain would not. And it's just uncertainty, and because of which there is certain panic and volatility, which presents an opportunity for investors to identify good investment opportunities right now, buy those stocks at a discount and sit tight.
Yes.
And this is like literally free money from that perspective.
Yes, average out all the investments that you have, maybe come to a closer downs. In this pretext that you spoke about, that if the world grows, India's you know, India has the youngest audience out there and the most amount of people who can go on a job right now. What sectors, and considering the tech boom that we're looking at, you know, a lot of jobs are not dependent on AI, ML, a lot of jobs will be automated. What sectors do you specifically think? Because there's construction in one way, then there's tech in one way, there's IT in one way, and then the intricacies of, you know, Internet of Things. So in this pretext, in the growth of India, what sectors do you believe will move forward better than the others?
So so here I'm just following a very simple equation, right? That it is very given that the per capita income of India will move from roughly $1,900 to $4,500 over the next 10 years. So which sectors will benefit from it, right? So all the sectors will benefit because there is more money coming in, but which sector will benefit more, right? So point one, I would definitely consider that people will take care of their health. So insurance sector will benefit a lot. It is highly underpenetrated. If people have excess money to invest, then all the investment oriented things will start gaining more traction. So these would be banks, these would be AMCs, which I'm very bullish about. Number three, it would be brand-oriented companies, right? For example, people will move away from locally manufactured things that are assembled on the fly. For example, I live very close to Agra, right? And there is a huge economy of making informal shoes. And if you want to gone and visited Agra 5 years ago, you would find a lot of people, like a lot of cobblers who would be weaving like shoes and manufacturing it in a hand-knit manner. But now if you go, that industry is shrinking, right? Because people are getting more and more organized. So this market share is being taken away by a lot of organized players in every sector, right? Be it HUL, be it Britannia, be it something like Asian Paints. They are taking away the market share from this unorganized sector. So I think these are three specific ways I would think about how India is growing. Interesting question could be that, you know what, where do you think, where you're not being very bullish about India, right? So I'm not being very bullish about India on tech, right? There is a specific reason why, because I'm more bullish on India on tech. Tech is wonderful, right? I'm more bullish on cryptos, right? I truly believe that something like smart contracts and decentralized finance is going to be a game changer. Every major bank is experimenting with it, with these technologies in some way or the other. India is not a primary mover here, right? And second, when it comes to even other major trends, for example, robotic process automation, right? So RPA, or if you talk about the next gen banking per se, then it's not happening in India. India is mostly a service oriented tech, right? Which is great, but fortunately that high end tech is not happening. So therefore I'm not putting my bets on tech in India. So I purchased.
If you look at it historically as well, the technology hubs of the world have been always outside India, in the way that you have Silicon Valley doing the things that they do, and the Silicon Valley of the East, which is Hong Kong. And these people have been at the center point of all the tech developments in the world. Now, because of their sheer size and magnitude, you see these guys being in a better position to, you know, create, you know, put money into R&D, create new products and services, integrate all that they have. And a new player coming in would be a little difficult. While we can implement as India a lot of things that they do better and make use of it, and we are going to, you know, make the most of what developments they do. But functionally, I believe we're like a little behind in years, you know, in terms of actually setting it up. And I'm hopeful that what Bangalore is up to nowadays would allow us to, you know, actually have a spot in the world, saying that, yeah, Bangalore is that place where everyone wants to go for tech. So that's crazy. And your thoughts are like the way you explained it, I'm pretty certain that people would understand why growth of India would actually lead to growth of various other sectors, and I'm really excited so that people now can take actually. So now moving forward, if there is something like this, you know, like now new investors are looking at, now they know that there are certain sectors that you need to look outside, you know, there are certain sectors that you can invest, go beyond India and do something that is out there. So would you want to give certain advice to people saying who are entering right now and want to invest in external things, like just a brief understanding of what do you need to look at when you're investing internationally? What are the small things that you need to take care of so that you don't get burned? If there's like a set of to-dos that you have to speak about.
So I think this is a very cliched advice, that you invest in things that you can understand, right? Please don't invest just because others are investing. That's point one, right? Point two is that you must be clear why you are investing outside India. If you're investing outside India, for example, my story is simple. I don't invest in tech in India. I invest outside India for tech, right? Because I genuinely feel that developed markets have more potential in this respect, because tech players are going to become global monopolies. They are not looking to become regional monopolies. So you're not going to, it's hard, it's harder, right? And the probability of finding the next Google in India, it's tougher than, you know, if you have to put your money in US or other countries from that perspective. So you need to be clear about your own narrative, that hey, if you're going outside India, why are you doing it, right? Third and finally, please be diversified, right? Because despite taking all the cautions, all the measures, you might be incorrect about certain bets. So please don't go all out just because you think that, you know what, this particular asset class, whatever you call it, it's going to be the next big thing. Let me sell my house. Let me sell my all the land that I have. And, you know, invest in this. Please don't do it. Please be well diversified. Yes. That's the central principle.
Awesome. Now that we're all geared up, we know what's happening in India. We know what's the sectors that are going to perform. Let's get to the crust of the conversation today, which is investing in Hong Kong. So Akshat, to understand, let us speak a little bit about Hong Kong in specific. the current dynamics, the fact that tech is going to lead. There's already Nasdaq and who's looking after the tech stocks, and then we have Hang Seng. So what are your thoughts now? If somebody has an opportunity to invest internationally, and he has America, and then he has Hang Seng and all the other markets as well, between these two, what are your thoughts on investing in Hong Kong or Hang Seng as they call it?
So my thoughts are, again, it ties into the principle that I was speaking earlier, which is principle of diversification. Where the current market stands is that China has taken a lot of beating in the stock markets right now. For example, something like Alibaba has lost its approximately 40-45% value in the last few months, right? Literally this year, right? So great value buying opportunity from that perspective, in my opinion. I had made a separate stock analysis of Alibaba on my channel also. So from that perspective, good, right? So the first key point to remember is that diversification point of view, you should be clear. Number two, if you are looking to invest in the Chinese index, then Hang Seng is really good, right? From that perspective, that it gives you those opportunities to explore a bunch of really good companies like Xiaomi, Tencent, bunch of other major players that are shaping the China economy. Third thing is, we sometimes get into an entire, if we put our rational investment hat on, it is the way. So couple of things, right, which absolutely needs to be considered, is that world is deeply integrated. Even if something like, forget about like China, India, US, Europe, these are major economic hubs now. Even if, right, for example, there is minor problem, right, somewhere in, let's say, Russia, right, or like central Russia, some country, right, it is going to impact the global markets all across the globe, right? So the point is that a lot of narrative is being built that, you know what, China is going to dust, it's not going to come back. That is not true. China is like a major economic superpower right now. It's it has gained a lot of ground in the last couple of decades. It has grown at an unprecedented pace. So it offers a series of opportunities. Invest if you understand. Otherwise, learn more about the space. But definitely, do not say that, you know, China is not going to make it. It's going to come back up. You know, if we keep our nationalistic sentiments aside, if we put on a thought process around the global economy, nations are working in tandem, right? They are working in partnership. In order for India to grow, we need China to grow also. World is abundant for everyone. The entire humanity needs to grow together from that perspective. It cannot happen that, you know what, only India grows and China will not grow at all. Or only China grows, India will not grow at all. It will not happen that
way. Damn. So considering that everybody needs to grow together and everybody has the same reasons to succeed in one form or the other, it's the supply chain, it's like this buying and selling of things at one form or the other. In such a context, what are the top factors that allow Hang Seng in general to be a better investment opportunity than some of the other markets? What do you think are the key you know, factors that will make, maybe, I'm not saying that Hang Seng will beat Indian index or something like that, but I'm saying, what are the top factors that can give an edge to Hong Kong over the Indian markets?
So I'm not sure about the edge per se, right? It's very difficult to sort of consider it as a battle between two economies. But if we just isolate Hong Kong or China from that perspective and try to see the growth there, is that region of the world going to grow? The answer is absolutely yes. Has it grown in the past? The answer is absolutely yes. Is it available at attractive prices right now because of all the beating China has taken due to COVID, and that the world has shunned China, right? There's a lot of backlash against China. Supply chains have been disrupted. The energy prices in China has gone up. There was this Evergrande crisis that right. So a lot of bad stuff has happened in China from that perspective. So value buying opportunities are there. So from an investor point of view, that makes like a sensible opportunity to at least look at it, right? If you understand it, then definitely start taking positions in it. So that's part A. Part B is that China has, if you study the history of China, it has been one of the richest nations or richest regions of the world throughout human civilization, right? So it's whether we like it or not, right? I mean, that's the fact, that's what history tells us. So assuming that it is not going to grow from this point of view because, because of wide variety of reasons, that is not correct. It is going to grow. It is going to scale up at a faster pace. It has directional government that part of governance does not appeal to us, or we could not possibly fathom how it works. But that system is working for them, right? So to each his own from that perspective. And all these are opportunities that investors can explore, and investors have been exploring it, right? Up until the point COVID hit, the investments in China were rising, right? It's only the last 1.5 years that the amount of investment or the quantum of investment has gone down.
Yes.
What's stopping it from coming in?
No, crazy, crazy thoughts. And in this pursuit, like Han Seng and the opportunities it brings, are there a couple of companies that you specifically look out for in the Han Seng index that really say that, you know, these are leaders and you need to be, you know? You made one video on Alibaba, which I'm sure of. I saw it myself about the kind of monopoly or moats that they build. Are there any other companies which have moats in the Han Seng index?
Right. So a very quick note about Alibaba. That was a value buying opportunity. When I made Alibaba, it was already down by like 30-35%, right, from its peak, right? It has gone down further, unfortunately, but it's still a very good value buy, in my opinion, right? And that is what several investors are also betting on, right? So that's a separate discussion. Now, coming to other companies, I would say that something like Tencent is really good, right? It's like, by investing in Tencent, you are investing in the entire ecosystem of China, right? Which is comprises of startups, financial institutions, bunch of different e-commerce startups, right? So it's a good bet from that perspective. I think consumer durables are going to continue to grow. That is not going to come down. So something like Xiaomi is very good, right? It is, very solid from that perspective. The business model is very sound, profitable. Yeah. So
and
I think
these are global companies, you know, like Xiaomi in India is like a household brand. You know, every second person I think may have a Xiaomi something, you know, and
compete on prices, right? So I mean, that is like functionality is one part of it, right? The competitive pricing and the production cost efficiency is the other part of the equation. So since they are able to do it at such a low price point, they are able to gain massive scale, right? People love to save money, right? And if you can get, they can get quality product at a low price, then that company is going to grow. Same issue is played out with Boat, right? So in India, Boat has grown really fast, right?
You're talking about the audio company, Boat, right?
Company, Boat, right, which produces earphones. If you look at it, history in the last, it has grown in like last 3 to 4 years, right? So that is when I purchased my first Boat earphones, right, at a very nominal price. So it has grown massively because it's offering good product at a cheap price. And if company is able to do it sustainably, so something like Xiaomi, then it will grow. Yeah.
Awesome. Awesome. So with this context, let's get into the fund itself and try to understand this opportunity. What are your thoughts about the Mirae Asset Hang Seng Tech Fund in general, you know, like for all the reasons that we spoke about, how India is performing, what world is going through, and the opportunities that we have in hand. This fund basically is a culmination of top 30 tech firms in China, you know, the Hang Seng fund, right? What are your thoughts of investing in some place like this?
Sure. So very honestly, right, number one, very difficult for us to parse through the data, especially for Indians, of exactly what is happening in China.
Yeah.
Which is both good and bad, right? Bad in the sense that, hey, we are not 100% clear what we are getting into. So therefore, probably going and investing in a fund makes more sense rather than individual stocks from that perspective. So this is point one. Point two, we need to take like a macro narrative, right? The macro narrative would be that, okay, China is growing. For China to grow, so question one, is China going to grow, right, in the next 5 years?
Okay. Yes.
What sectors in China are going to grow? Okay, banking is that, right? It is going to grow. Tech, is it going to grow? Absolutely, right? So tech is also going to grow quite extensively in China, right? If you consider even American companies like Tesla, their largest sales come outside US, it comes from China, right? So from that perspective, investing in a fund gives you that opportunity to take advantage of diversification, right, which is good. So if you don't understand much about China, if you can't analyze individual stocks, better approach is just go with a fund, because your risk gets diversified in top companies, right? So from that perspective, I'm like bullish from that angle.
No, it makes sense. Like something that you don't know entirely, you should probably get into it in groups, you know, so that you're saved by the herd and you're not dependent on like the same all your eggs in one basket phenomena. So we have another guest on house, and before we go to that, I want to put in a little bit of quiz for people to understand certain aspects of the Fang Fund, you know, Hansing Fund, that'll allow them to understand the gravity and intensity. So we'll do a couple of questions, and then we directly invite Mr. Siddharth Srivastava, and I'll allow you to have a bit of conversation that way. So there are five questions on the quiz, and I just want to ask all the viewers to give in, you know, like create, have a look at all these questions and answer these in the comment box. Somebody from my team will have a look at it and send you surprise goodies. What that is, I will not tell you right now, but if you answer all five by the end of the show, subscribe to the YouTube channel so that you know when we're typing and you'll know when you win, right? So the first question is, how many of the global Fortune 500 companies are in China? Okay, this is the first question, and I'll go to the second question. Take your time, and you have to answer before the end of the show, right? And there are good things that you will learn. Let's go to the second question. Second question says, do you know how many internet users are in India? You know, a couple of years ago, before Jio came in, the number for India was close to about 350 million. Now that has changed to something else. Imagine China is a little bit more than us in population. How much would they have? So that's the other question. The third is, how many, because everything's about tech, right? And how we're getting into Internet of Things. How many percentage of patent applications do you think are coming from China right now? You know, kind of proprietary tech knowledge. Fourth is, how much does China account for global food trade? You know, in terms of consumption, how much percentage of food, global food trade is accounted for China? And the last is, what is China's GDP, China's contribution to global GDP, right? This is the fourth question on the screen right now. And the fifth question and the final question is, what is China's share in world GDP? So answer these five questions, and somebody will find you. And if you're lucky enough, you'll get some goodies. So moving to the most important part, let's introduce the fund manager, where I'm a little less relevant, and then Akshat can directly speak to the man himself. So introducing Siddharth Srivastava, and Siddharth is someone I've worked with in the past as well. We've launched a couple of NFOs together, so I know him a little bit. But to give him a brief understanding of what Siddharth's been up to and trying to help us out, you know, is 1 second. Yes. So Siddharth is the ETF products head at Mirae Asset. And Mirae Asset, before I talk about Siddharth, I can speak about Mirae Asset itself. Mirae Asset is a fund house that has given you one of the top performing mutual funds that there are out there. They have access to passive and actively managed fund, and have people like Siddharth Srivastava himself who look after it. So Siddharth has more than 10 years of experience, and that's the most common bit. But if you understand that he has his own ideology, he has his own thought buildup, which allows him to look at it from a retail point of view and build products for us, which actually make a dent in the market. So Siddharth, without further ado, I would want you to say a little bit about yourself, which we don't know right now, which is beyond and above the LinkedIn resumes of the world. And let us know a little bit about what brings you here today.
First of all, thank you, Mazammil, and thank you, Akshat, for having me here. A very short introduction. I head ETF products at Mirae Asset. I joined Mirae Asset in 2018, when we were roughly around 20,000 crores in terms of AUM, and we recently crossed 1 lakh crores in total managed assets. And that's something which has obviously, which is great. And not only we have now good products on the active side, but we are trying to build up our passive vertical as well, which me and the ETF team takes care of. Before this, I was associated with National Stock Exchange and Morgan Stanley Capital International, both index-related work. So my background is mostly related to benchmarks, indices, and here I'm managing the ETF products, which extract the indices and benchmarks.
No, crazy. And I know you personally, so So I get awed by whatever you've done so far, but it's important for our viewers to know the person you are and the association we have. So on this platform, what we're going to do is Akshat and I have spoken about the importance and the legitimacy of the opportunity that is out there through various perspectives and ideas. What we want to do now is, because Akshat speaks to so many people on the go, you know, he has more exposure than I have in terms of what are the problems of these people when it comes to investing in general. So Akshat, I would want you to use this opportunity to ask certain questions to Siddharth, which you think are the questions of the masses and something that you keep getting on by investing in China or something similar to what we have. So if there are certain questions, let's have this round where you are representing the masses and Siddharth is obviously representing Mirai Asset. So please have a go, you know, let the battle begin.
All right. Okay, so, hi Siddharth. So I would like to ask a few questions, right? I think I've been getting these type of questions quite extensively from the audiences, especially around China investing. So one is that if you can help us understand more about the risk reward equation involved in terms of investing in China, especially given the fact that these state actors in China have been very proactive over the last year. It has reflected in the stock price of Alibaba also. So how do you see the risk reward equation playing out? Is it a good time to invest? What would happen if there is more intervention from the government? How do you see this entire equation playing out?
So I think that's a great question, great first question. I think probably I'll need some time to answer that in terms of, I'll be taking maybe 4 or 5 minutes to answer. So please bear with me. So first of all, and I think you've already spoken about that why invest in global markets, right? All of us are so interlinked right now. If I want to come from home on the way, if I'm not driving, I'm checking my Instagram or Twitter. When I'm coming home, I'm watching Netflix. I'm buying things on Amazon. I'm surfing on Google, and I'm using things like Zoom, right? So we are using so many things and so many disruptive things, right? And these, what we are referring to are emerging and disruptive technologies. Let's say EVs, autonomous vehicles, cloud, e-commerce, social media. These things have created new economies. It is being referred to as fourth industrial revolution, right? Now we are seeing momentum on Internet of Things, semiconductors, lithium batteries, etc. So first of all, the reason why people should explore global markets is to invest in these opportunity sets, right? People have seen Apple and Google growing so well. Why shouldn't they be allowed to invest in those companies? And people know that EV and autonomous vehicles, probably blockchain, you referred to cryptos. A lot of these technologies seems to have very good future. So if someone wants to take position in that, they should have the product in which they can take exposure in, right? And one very basic thing is that Indian equity markets, while we all have domestic bias, we want to invest in Indian equity markets, it's roughly around 3% of global markets. So opportunities outside India is more than 90% in terms of number of companies, in terms of investing in Fortune 500 companies, in terms of investing in these emerging and disruptive technologies. So people are very keen and we have seen significant traction in investing globally. First step, typically people invest in US, right? And this I wanted to just talk step by step because probably people won't be inclined towards investing in China at the first go, right? It's a step-by-step process, right? Foreign investing in India is still gaining traction. So investing in US market because of familiarity, because we track US more than any other market, right? How it is behaving, what actions Fed is taking, it affects not only US, but global markets also. So, and it can very well form part of your core portfolio, something like S&P 500, top 50, S&P 500 itself. You can invest in a product like a FANG Plus, which we came out, tracks 10 best companies on the tech side. Now, if you want to diversify further, right, if you want to take opportunities in other markets, the next step can be based on Greater China market, right? If you look at top 7 exchanges in the world from a market cap point of view, 3 are linked to China, Shenzhen, Shanghai, and Hong Kong Stock Exchange. So seven out of top three, and they provide again exposure to companies which have become giants of East, right? We look at Google, FANG in West, right? Facebook, Amazon, Netflix, Google, Apple, etc. in West. We look at Baidu, Alibaba, Tencent, etc. in East now, and they have grown so significantly. So if someone wants to take exposure in these Eastern giants, right? The giants which are catering to a huge domestic population, right? We are talking about consumer base of around 1 billion people who are on internet. So China market from that point of view seems very attractive. Having said that, and your question was why China, right? From a risk reward point of view. Unlike India, where you'll typically find a flexi cap fund or a large cap fund or a Nifty 50 or a Sensex 30, probably having similar sector exposure, right? With some amount of difference, right? You'll find similar HDFC twins, IT consultancies, etc., as top holdings. And probably the risk reward is similar. It's very important that audience know that risk reward can be very different when it comes to global investing. Two funds within US can behave very differently because of there are so many options, so many types of themes which are available for investing, so many companies which are available for investing. The product can be constructed in very different manner. So, and now coming to China market has behaved very differently from how Indian markets have done, how US markets have done. And for example, in last 7 calendar years, if I take 5 calendar years, China market has outperformed India significantly. In fact, there are years you'll see even outperformance by, let's say, around 50%, around 33%. But then there are years like 2018, and we know that this year, because of regulatory issues, it has underperformed significantly also, right? So there have been periods where it has done really well, and there have been a couple of years where, because of XYZ reason, it has faced volatility and drawdowns have been significant. So I feel that anyone who wants to invest in China, it's a very good opportunity set. If we look before these regulatory headwinds, let's look at Feb ending data. They outperformed Indian markets by more than 10% in last 5 years, 3 years. In last 1 year, they outperformed by almost 50% plus. In last 2 years, by almost 33%. So they have created wealth. As you mentioned, right now, because of these 40% correction, it's probably a sweet valuation spot to enter into. I think you said that you have invested in Alibaba when it was down 35%. But having said that, it is more risky, more volatile, and it's more suited to people who have higher risk appetite.
All right, so Siddharth, one very quick rebuttal to that would be that, hey, and this is a question that I'll keep on getting, that great, I understand the point that Chinese market probably like can beat India on certain dimensions. Historically, it might have given better returns, but here's my counter argument, right? That I understand about Indian companies. I feel safe about investing in Indian companies and US companies. At least I know that the data that I'm getting, it's reliable. If I go and try to even invest in China, I just don't know like what data to trust, what data not to trust. There can be blanket bans that can be imposed. There's a lot of shakiness associated with that market. So any piece of advice that you will give me in terms of learning more about this market, where should I start to build that understanding or that conviction for me to start taking bets in the Chinese market?
So first of all, as I mentioned earlier, that when you're investing, see, it's all about portfolio construction, how you are creating the entire portfolio. It's not a question of or, whether should I invest in Indian or US or China market. The answer is and, right? That you need to have exposure in Indian markets. As you said, that India has a very good opportunity because of the demographics, right? Because of the sheer size. US has significant opportunity because it is leading the tech revolution. It is the hub of innovation and obviously huge companies. And then China, right? China is the second largest economy in the world. It has, there's no denying the fact that China in last 40, 50 years has grown at an average pace of more than 9%, which is the fastest growth recorded for a large economy in history, right? Even in last 10 years, it has grown at a pace of, again, average around 9%. Last year, when COVID was there, all the major economies had a recession, right? A negative GDP growth. China was the only one with positive GDP growth. This year also, while the projections have been lowered from 9%, it is still strong at 7.8%. So I think, yes, there is opaqueness related to China. There's no denying that. It is a different kind of setup politically and from a regulation point of view. And we expect headwinds, right? Like what we are facing right now in terms of regulations, and probably we can discuss about it more later. But then this is not something which you should look from a core portfolio point of view, right? You can have a more tactical exposure or a more satellite exposure and have an exposure of, let's say, up till 5%. Because right now, as you, there are two things which are going in favor of investing in China right now. One, globally, Indian markets, US markets, most of the other markets are trading at premium, double-digit premium. Valuations are high. We all know that, right? While it may be justified from the future potentials, which we are seeing in terms of earnings growth, but it is high. These companies, China, Hang Seng Tech is around 40% discount, right? That is one. Second, we all know how well these companies have grown, how well soft tech companies like Baidu, Alibaba, Tencent, Xiaomi, Haier, Kuaishou, Meituan, etc. have grown. And these are good businesses which are available at a very cheap price from a future prospect point of view. We expect not only them to continue catering to the huge domestic audience, but also probably make inroads outside also. And this portfolio also have, let's say, exposure to other hard tech companies also. It's not about only software, right? When I am talking about tech right now, in India, when we talk about tech, we think about IT consultancy and some software because that is our landscape. But if you look globally, if you look at Hang Seng Tech, you are getting exposure to electric vehicles, battery manufacturers, semiconductors, companies involved in autonomous vehicles, companies involved in healthcare IT, social media, e-commerce, smartphones like Xiaomi, etc. So it's a big exposure you're giving to a huge landscape. But again, probably you can start with a very small amount of exposure in this particular product. If you feel comfortable, then you increase it. It's not something where I'll say that when we did S&P 500 top 50, we're talking about it being a core portfolio. You can go up till 10-15% in that product because that is how well it is from a known exposure point of view. Probably here we'll talk about more so having a smaller exposure where you can get that kicker in return if it recovers well.
Absolutely. So I'll just quickly summarize some key things that I've learned through this conversation with you so far. So one is that the Chinese economy can be considered as a diversification advantage, right? So definitely, as a sensible investor, it's okay to take certain positions depending on your portfolio growth, portfolio style of investing. That's point one. Second point is that there is a lot of reservation in terms of investing in China because we don't know. There are like a lot of nuances to its politics, a lot of nuances to its data. But one key thing that you as a macro investor could understand, could bet on, is the fact that, hey, no matter which the political party is in China, what steps they are taking, they are doing it with the intent of growing the GDP, right? I mean, it's not as if that because there is political party A and it gets replaced by political party B or whatever politics happens there. Their intent is to grow the GDP of China. If the Chinese GDP continues to grow at 7.5, 8, 9% CAGR, which it has done in the past, then overall the businesses associated with it will automatically grow. So from that perspective, if you want it to be a good diversification, if you consider China to be a good diversification edge, it could be a possibility that you can take certain bets on it from that perspective. So these are my questions. I think we have covered a lot of grounds in terms of just asking two questions. I think Muzammil is back.
No, it was crazy. I'm the backstage trying to understand why I'm not one of two people who are talking right now, because there's so much knowledge that comes only with experience and time in the market that it's important to listen. And I was really happy that I didn't have to be in the frame and speak to you guys on the same topic. So I think this conversation has been really, really fruitful from my perspective, who've been in the market for some time, I think, and from people who have not been at all and are looking at, high disposable incomes and trying to put in money. So it was a great association that we tried to bring upon. And I really want to thank Akshat, Siddharth for coming on stage, coming on the platform and helping us do this better. I really, really want to ask you guys if there are any, parting thoughts that you would want to give to new-to-market customers, retail investors, and I wouldn't say customers, but retail investors, like a giving thought, like the moral of the story of sorts for everyone who are beginning their journey. That'll be great from each one of you. And then we can conclude the session and tell you more about what we have in store in the coming weeks.
Siddharth, about you go first and then
I'll go. Sure. I think the way I'll summarize is that global markets offer significant opportunities to take exposure in different economies, different themes. It is very exciting. So, but before doing that, understand the product, just understand what sort of exposure it is providing. And if it suits your risk appetite, gradually start investing in global markets in order to create a better portfolio.
Right. So my final thoughts on the topic would be more from a macro viewpoint, which is the principle of diversification. Now we live in a very uncertain world. We don't know which part of the world will grow versus not. So it's important to be diversified, not only in terms of your skill set, that you should develop new skills, you should figure out more ways to make money. And you should also be diversified in the way that you invest, right? So be it in terms of geography hedge, be it in terms of different good companies that you are investing. And always invest in good assets. That's the primary goal. And you are able to do it if you learn more, study more, watch these type of sessions. And that can act a good facilitator for us to understand more about everything that is going around. So yeah, so build your knowledge base and pick the right bits in terms of asset classes.
Awesome. And a little bit, what I could say is not as valuable as the other two guys, but I believe there's some new economies coming up, like the gaming economy in itself. PUBG and games like that have created a social network and ecosystem in itself. And these companies are basically from like Tencent, PUBG, and then you have the entire ecosystem that's happening in Android. So a lot of new things coming out, which were not the traditional sources of income, and you need to keep an eye out. So if you're not investing heavily, if you're not allocating a lot of things, then new things out there which work, which you've seen working. So might as well discover them through, passive funds, which have collated a lot of, balance it out through diversification and have an exposure. Just figure out, is what I wanted to say. So thank you very much. And I'm really excited. And I'm really hoping that Akshat, I can get you back again on one of the other shows that we have, but crazy. And before we sign off, I just want everyone to subscribe because we're doing this weekly now. We have people like Akshat coming in every week, every Sunday. We're planning to do every Sunday, but now we're doing 2 a week. So if you subscribe and, just press the bell icon, you'd get a notification the next time we're going live. If my support team can just put on the next event that we're doing, we can show the next event. And we have Ms. Swati Kumari coming in who has another very important channel on YouTube called as Be Wealthy. And we would be discussing on investing in the future of India. That'll be the next thing. So if you're excited, please join us again. So thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Akshat. Thank you, Siddharth. Siddharth, we've been talking and we continue to talk. But it was a pleasure talking to all of you. And I really genuinely believe that people took out really, really valuable stuff from this. So thank you very much again, and looking forward to work with you guys again.
That's great. Thank you so much.
Awesome. See you guys. Cheerio.